Bruce, you must have something really good too.
Of course I do. It's Bruce Danielson, and I guess I'm here to entertain you too.
And this is Black History Month, and that is part of why this program here is so important, is Cleveland Abbott, and Bruce is going to talk about this. I am so fortunate to have made the acquaintance with Bruce by virtue of an invitation from Greta Chapman, South Dakota Hall of Fame. Would you wave your hand, Greta? Give her a round of applause. This is all Greta's fault. She invited me down to the South Dakota Hall of Fame because Nicholas Black Elk was going in, and then from there, all kinds of other things happen, and I run into Bruce. But this is a really fabulous story, and I think you guys are just going to be amazed. But at this point, I will turn this over to Mr. Bruce Danielson, and you guys will be a great crowd, right? It's his first time ever, okay?
Our next inductee tonight, Cleve Abbott, and he is represented tonight by Bruce Danielson.
Thank you. Long before there was a Venus or Serena Williams, LeBron James, Carl Lewis, or Jackie Robinson, a man born into Alabama slavery would help create athletes and change our lives. Because of hard economic times, a former slave, Albert Abbott, and his bride, Molly, moved to South Dakota to raise a family. Their oldest child, Cleveland Abbott, was born in Yankton to 1894 life disadvantages most of us would never fully understand today. At an early age, Cleveland Abbott trained his body like he trained his mind. Cleveland Abbott excelled in everything he attempted. South Dakotans who know of Cleveland Abbott know his amazing local sports scorecard. But for the Abbotts and our ancestors, there was no separate beat equal in South Dakota. The hard prairie life was equally hard for all. As a 19-year-old, Cleveland Abbott's academic and sports reputation was enough for Tuskegee Institute's founder, Booker T. Washington, the Booker T. Washington, to recruit him to quietly lead an effort to help break American Jim Crow segregation through sports. This child, brought up with a South Dakota idea he could do anything, would find ways to create possibilities for young men and women not allowed to dream. Likely shocking his parents, this oldest child of the former slave would return to their Alabama roots to help break American segregation. Cleveland Abbott used all the education and skills honed in Watertown and at South Dakota State to give him the ability to know the value of a person is not color-based. South Dakota gave Cleveland Abbott opportunities and experiences he would not have had growing up in the Deep South. With his wife, Jessie, Cleveland Abbott created the first organized women's college athletic programs. He created opportunities for all students modeled on programs he participated in as a kid in South Dakota. His Tuskegee teams then went on to rule national track and field events for decades. The Tuskegee athletic programs, and especially the relays, were created to showcase all young men and women. They became the model for what we now experience at every NCAA event. Cleveland Abbott created opportunities for talented student athletes, regardless of race. Cleveland Abbott created a model for modern colorblind world of international sports. It was not a fluke that within months of taking over Tuskegee's football team, Cleveland Abbott and the Golden Tigers were national champions. This was accomplished several more times over the next 32 years. Cleveland Abbott inspired kids who had nothing to feel like they could help change the world just by their very dreams and actions. His students went on to become world leaders using the example he lived. The world wanted his students and Cleve Abbott to teach the rest of us how to be successful. As a result, the revered Duke of Dakota, Cleveland Abbott, was asked to be the first black member of the USA Track and Field Board in about 1940. By 1946, he was selected to be a member of the US Olympic Committee. His humble South Dakota beginnings stayed with him. He honors all of us through his excellence. In his short life, he was able to blend raw talent with a superb mind to help break the rules of American segregation. The quiet excellence and dignity of Cleveland Abbott should teach all of us what one brave person can do to change the world. On behalf of the South Dakota African American History Museum, located in Sioux Falls, it is an honor to accept this induction of Cleve Abbott, not for himself, but as he would have asked, on behalf of his students. While his national championships created a scorecard, Cleve Abbott's life was an example of a true champion, a South Dakota champion. Thank you very much.
First, I'd like to thank Greta and her team for making that such an amazing experience. It was something that I never figured I would ever do, and they made it so pleasurable. And I left some materials on all of the tables that I could with information about the Hall of Fame. If you people get a chance to go there, I think that you would really enjoy this opportunity to see it. About a year ago, I was asked to help get Cleve Abbott into the Hall of Fame. I knew just a little bit about him, and it didn't really excite me very much when I first heard about him, because he was this person that, well, okay, he earned a bunch of Letterman's jacket letters. He earned 30 of them in 8 years of high school and college. It's pretty outstanding, but you know, why should he be in a Hall of Fame for that? So I went out and I started reading a little bit about him. And I ended up calling down to Tuskegee, and I got a hold of a researcher that was amazing. And Cheryl sent me this little article about, she goes, I can't find very much on him, but I found this little article, and he had been speaking to the Fellowship of Christian Athletes. It's a very religious school, and you know, this was teaching God and country and hard work. And so he is 29 years old, and he's quoting the Greek philosopher Prometheus. And it's like, holy moly, you know, this was amazing. So I called her and I said, this is exactly what I'm looking for. But the worth of a man is what you're going to see, that he lived the words of Prometheus. So I have taken the idea that we have Abbeville down in the southern part of Alabama going, and he ends up in Tuskegee. His parents what they went through to escape from Abbeville was amazing. You know, I think they came up on a steamship, to Yankton. They homesteaded in Yankton County. That didn't work out, apparently, so they went up to Brookings, and then they ended up in Watertown, and their son ends up going back 80 miles from where it all started, where Albert had been born a slave. And that just, to this day, amazes me that he got to go through these gates as an instructor and as a coach. And so in 1906, it was the 20th anniversary. This is before Cleve was there. Cleve was a young boy, but they had the 25th anniversary of the Tuskegee Institute. And the Tuskegee Institute was actually a school, like you'd have STI. It was a high school, it was a junior college, and that was about all it was. So there were, the state of Alabama had established a series of institutes for teaching the colored people. And what Booker T. Washington, and Booker T. Washington is the one over here, the second from the right. This is Andrew Carnegie, William Howard Taft, and one of the inspirational speakers of the time for inclusion and civil rights by the name of Ogden. Mark Twain was there. This was a big, huge event at Carnegie Hall. And the reason I bring this up is we'll be coming through and all this is the information I've been gathering. Every time I read something about this man, he's done something else. But now in Molly Brown Abbott died in 1909 when Cleve is a freshman in high school. Now you think about all the things that they're going through. His dad is a brick mason, he's been a barber, he's been trying to be a farmer, he's tried everything. And now his wife dies and he's left with seven children to raise. And we have Cleve Abbott now motherless. So he goes through high school and college. And during high school in 1911, he's the star reporter for the Watertown paper for all the high school events. I think about him and think about the precociousness, the ingenuity, the being involved. He just amazes me every way possible. In the introduction, I was trying to get that picture in here, but it didn't get done. But there was a photograph of the football team. And you could see the love that was going on with those boys, with Cleve being in the center of the picture, and they've got their hands on him. Like, he's one of us. It was just kind of amazing to me. This is when he was a freshman at South Dakota State College. You know, SDSU didn't become a university until 1964. So it was SDSC prior to that. So you'll see the references in here to South Dakota State College. And this is the Watertown newspaper, and the community wanted to keep in touch with what Cleve was up to, because he was one of them. The inclusion of Cleveland and his ability to win, you know, all of those 16 letters, athletic letters, plus his academic skills, while President Preschoell was at a meeting in New York, and he's riding the train out of New York, he runs into Booker T. Washington, so they end up having a conversation. They were at the same meeting about the advancement of colored people. So he's sitting there on the train, and apparently they had this conversation, and Booker T. Washington asks Preschoell if he knew of any kids that could come and teach football. And he says, I have this student. And so there was a deal made. If you go in, and if Cleve was able to keep his academics up and his athletic skills, he had a job as soon as he graduated. And that was in 1914. 1915, Booker T. Washington died. So if you can imagine the heartbreak that Cleve probably felt hearing that Booker T. Washington died. and he graduates in 1916. James Washington, Booker's adopted brother, got a hold of Cleve to make sure that he was coming upon graduation. And that was one of those amazing things that happened in this man's life. And he took advantage of those dreams that he could have. He was lettered for 4 years. Every year he was on the team. In fact, he was on some regional teams, national teams. He was kind of an all-star. He was the center, and he was on a national-rated team. They won championships, and it was amazing what he was able to go through. So, of course, the Watertown paper had to put the story in that he graduated from South Dakota State, and I have another article that his father is talking about going to the graduation ceremony. I'm digging out all kinds of little trivia from the most amazing places. So in World War I is started, and they have to get all of these troops they have the draft. He becomes the listed first because of the alphabet. He's listed the first of the first 350 commissioned officers brought in that are colored into the U.S. Army. And he is commissioned as a member of the Buffalo Soldiers, the reincarnated Buffalo Soldiers. He is serving in the Argonne. If you know the battles of France, some of the worst battles that the Americans got involved in was the Argonne, and he led troops in that. He was so well loved and respected by the brass and by the troops that, according to what I've been able to find out, is he was asked to read the armistice statement on November 11th, 1918, ending the war to the colored troops. Then the Watertown paper, all through that time period, is keeping track of all of these guys that have been brought into the service. And he's, of course, right on the top of that list. I have to tell you a little story. You may have noticed four runners at the Drake relays in the original video. This is a side story to all of this. He met his future bride at a church social at the Drake relays in 1916. 1917, has to go to Fort Des Moines. I haven't found any evidence of this yet, but I have a feeling they rekindled their friendship. And in 1919, he goes back for the closing ceremony. And I was thinking, why would you go back to the closing ceremony? Except probably because Jesse had decided that Cleve was going to be her husband, and they ended up being married at some point in there. So they attended this. All through this, there are the national football teams they won 80 some games before they had a loss. That's unheard of. The other side of it was little things like former student from 1914 to 1918 was this Eddie Gardner. And this was one of those, if you remember the 1920s and the endurance runs, and everybody had the endurance dances, and they, tried to push the body beyond. This gentleman in the center is the national star of all of the endurance runners. He was in a 3,500-mile race, and he stopped in Tuskegee. And so he's standing there on the Booker T. Washington Memorial. Another side to all of this, and how Cleve was able to bring his story to the world as Booker T. Washington wanted him to do, was we had this Negro press that developed. And they went out and constantly told stories about, like, you'll see Tuskegee. Every one of these sports pages has a story about Cleve Abbott and Tuskegee. and what they were able to do. And they were keeping track of them. They were rooting for them to such a point that we ended up having Cleve found a gentleman, a kid down in Kansas, when he had been part, Cleve had been part of the Kansas Vocational Technical School, or the Tuskegee of the West, for a couple of years. He found this gentleman right here, and his name is Ross Owen. And Ross C. Owen must have been an amazing football player and an athlete. He ended up going to South Dakota State, and graduating from South Dakota State, Cleve Abbott hires him to come and be his assistant football coach. Between Cleve is this guy here on this end, and then the guy in the total white there is Ross Owen. Between those two, for over 50 years, they ran the athletic department of Tuskegee. Two guys from South Dakota State. So we had, you'll find in here how there's all these ties to all of these successful athletes. They were breaking segregation. They were breaking that thought that these people with color can't do anything. And this is, you know, we had the Defender, we had the Detroit Tribune, we had all of these newspapers all through these large cities, to the point where they would have national tournaments, or they would have these Turkey Day battles or Thanksgiving battles, where Tuskegee would go to these cities and they would pack the northern stadiums with 20,000 people. I mean, those were huge stadiums in those days. And they would pack these stadiums with people to watch these African Americans play football. This story here, all of these different stories, where they would go from Chicago to Detroit to Cleveland to New York, they played these games, and Abbott needed to take his students through the northern states to learn what he and Jesse knew. They ended up taking, and we'll get into a few more things, but they ended up taking chances. Here is the drum major from Tuskegee who could kick. Abbott put her in as the kicker at one of these games. Women could do anything, and we'll talk about a little more of this, but they gave him that chance to do things and to dream. And that's what I love about this man. Here is a story of a girl from sharecropper land in the South. And Cleve Abbott worked with her, and she became the first woman to earn an Olympic gold, a black woman to earn an Olympic gold medal. And she went on to just go back to being a teacher, and I've actually talked with her son. But it was amazing. And they all revered Cleve and what he was able to do. But she stayed in high jumping. She was a member of the 1938 Tuskegee 10 group that I'll show you here in a moment. But she stayed in until she could win a gold medal. So we didn't have Olympics in 40 and 44, so she stayed in 48 and she still won. This gentleman is an incredible athlete, and he won the Drake Relay in 1938. But you know, the war got in the way, so he wasn't able to go to the Olympics. The Tuskegee 10. There is a group of amazing women, and it was a young girl had walked up to Cleve one day and said, Can I run with the boys? Well, that wasn't acceptable. You know, women in those days had to wear long skirts. That, you know, they you know, we're talking Bible Belt South. They're not gonna allow these people to show any skin or do things. Well, they ended up deciding, and Jesse was a big push on this, was We need to have this program, and we need to find a way. So they had chaperones for all of the team, so that those girls never did anything wrong, risque, anything. That it is, it's fun to listen to this recording that I have of Jesse Abbott telling about going in and doing the chaperoning and what was going on and what they had to do. And we'll talk about a couple more things that they had to do. But right now, from 1936 to 1950, they ruled women's track and field in the United States, not just the historically black colleges, nationally. And that's why Cleve was brought into the Olympics and USA track and field, because of these women right here. There's a movie out right now, and I have to recommend everybody go see it. It is just an incredible movie. It tells about the Green Book and how it was used in the 1960s. But as I listened to Jesse Abbott tell the story in this oral history about using the book, and using this book to know where they could get gas, where they could get water, where they could get anything, this is the book. And this tells you, if you're in this town, you know, Negroes can be here, and you know, you can't eat here, but you can sleep here, you can do this, you know, and stay away from this area. That was the Green Book. And they talked about, in some of the writings that I have, about riding in the little buses and in the little cars that they had in order to get through some of these towns and not be harassed. So I really recommend the movie. I really love this one. We've got an article here talking about, this is in 1946, and Jackie Robinson goes into the majors in 1947. And he is side by side where Cleveland Abbott was named the head of the American Tennis Association. Because what he and Jesse did to start a tennis program for the black Americans, and they had tennis tournaments, and they built that you could go in and learn something and be just as good as anybody. This one blew me away. I just learned this a few days ago. As I'm researching, I found out that 21 football players had died in 1946 because they were still using the leather helmets. Cleveland was asked to be on the committee of five to go in and design a modern football helmet that could stop the brain injuries of the day. So those of us of that gray hair age right now and got to wear football helmets, we have Cleve and his group to thank for that. He also liked to take pictures. I would love to get some of his pictures, but I love this photo. I believe that's at the stadium that he designed and had built. His father died in 1952, and I was able to gather all the names of the children to make sure that I have them, and I'm trying to do the research to find whatever happened to all the children and how they dispersed. So that just kind of tied in some of the things that I was working on otherwise. In 1954, he was reappointed. So all of these years, from 46 to 54, he is on the U.S. Olympic Committee. And then he dies in April of 1955. And the reverence that was paid to him and the articles that I've been able to find about his death and what was going on. This is if you remember that original picture that I showed with the runner, and the building in the background is the chapel that he's being carried out of. This is his grave marker. And if you remember, prior to World War I, we were all state regimental-based U.S. Army. So he was part of the South Dakota Regiment. So that's why he had to go back and be drafted out of Watertown, because that's where he signed up for the draft originally. and not through Alabama. And so the this grave is actually right here. And Booker T. Washington's grave is right over here. George Washington Carver's grave is in the other corner. The so this is Jesse Abbott. Sometime, I'm assuming after, I haven't been able to get a date on it yet, but after the death of Cleve, she was Booker T. Washington's wife's secretary. She was George Washington Carver's secretary. She was with George Washington Carver when he died, because George Washington Carver never married, so she would help out. And so in 1942, when he died, she was there. She also was so instrumental in saying, I believe she would have said, Cleve, you can do it. We can do this, you know, because it sounded like the two of them had a way with that. And the little story that she told in the oral history was, she was at that social at the Drake Relay, and she saw this big strapping guy she'd heard about come walking in. And she said she turned to a friend and said, that's my husband. And so I believe that Cleve was the hunted. So he's in 12 different Hall of Fames that I can find so far. These are just a couple of them. He was actually in the first Hall of Fame class from the National Football Hall of Fame. He's also the 34th winningest football coach in American history of any football. And he has a one-loss record they can't even come close to, because how many guys are going to be able to say that they coached 350 games? It's 66%. It's that in there. It's amazing. This is Abbott Field. And Abbott Field started out as Alumni Stadium. He needed a place that they could do the Tuskegee Relays. He needed a place where they could build football. They needed a place to prove that they could do whatever they wanted to do. And so this was improved over time, but that is the field that Abbott built, and it's now called Abbott Stadium. These are the types of things that he got involved in. He reactivated the Turkey Day Classics between the historically black colleges so that they could draw crowds. And they still hold this to this day. So this is one of the favorite things that I've been able to say about him, is his national champions created a scorecard. Cleveland Abbott's life was an example of a true champion, the South Dakota champion. Thank you.
I know you guys, I've already prepped Bruce and said, you'll have questions, so go ahead and get after him. Questions that you guys might not know, this is probably a topic you guys aren't so familiar with.
I've got a question.
Sure.
How was he able to play at South Dakota State back in that day?
There's a story about when he was, academically, he was amazing in high school. That's what I'm told from what I can find. He gets a chance to go to South Dakota State. He walks down, he walks into the registrar's office, and they ask him, what do you want to major in? And he sees the word dairy. So, okay, I'm a dairy student. That's all, and according to what he wrote, that's how he became there. So, I haven't been able to find anybody to tell me if he got a scholarship or how he got it, but he ended up going to South Dakota State for those 4 years. And the things that I have a lot of photos that I didn't put in here, but he could play golf, tennis, you name it, he did it, and he lettered in it.
Was there ever anything that said that other teams wouldn't play because they had a colored guy on the team?
No. North of the Mason-Dixon, you have to understand, prior to 1920, The NFL was both any race. They wanted to win. It didn't matter. It wasn't until the Cleveland, Ohio team was developed, as I remember my notes, that they that the NFL it became segregated until 1933. So they broke the segregation barrier long before. There was like 13 players who colored players who had played football for the in the pros. So it wasn't unusual north of the Mason-Dixon. Now, I've been reading about stories of people that played in the South would not, like Alabama, until about 1980, would not play against a black player. And so they lost a lot of chances to play in national tournaments because they wouldn't play the right ones.
So how did his parents ever get yanked in South Dakota in the first place?
Well, you have to understand that at that time period, we had the land rush in South Dakota. And they were coming up, and to go through that history, this is something I learned in college, and I never thought I'd ever revisit this, but I was a history major, and I had this incredible instructor who came from Dallas, South Dakota. And she started telling the stories of the black community that settled Dallas, South Dakota. And all along the river, the Blakeys, I got to know some of the Blakeys back in the 60s because they were friends of my uncle who lived in Yankton. So up through along the river, all the way up from the south, there were these communities of black individuals that settled looking for a way to get out of the places like Abbeville. And so that's how they ended up here. They were just part of that mass movement.
When are you going to write your book?
I've been, that's one of those things you think about when you're doing this, because I think this needs to be a movie, personally.
Yes.
There's, I'll tell you one of the fun stories, if you don't mind. Now I'll get to your question. The great Olympian Carl Lewis, 4 gold medals in the 1980s, and to this day he's a spectacular individual. His mother was a Cleve Abbott student. Cleve Abbott met her when she was a child and got her, just like Mildred McDaniel, got her first shoes. And because they were such natural athletes, her parents were convinced by Cleve Abbott that she should come to Tuskegee. She should graduate from school, because in those days, if you got to the eighth grade, that was more than anybody needed to be. Well, he convinced her to go to high school and found a way for her parents to earn enough money to help defray the expense of going to school. Cleve Abbott guided this whole process, and she went to the Pan American Games. She did all kinds of amazing stuff. She got injured, so she wasn't able to go to the 1952 Olympics. But in that whole process, she got an education, she got married, she had children. One of them was Carl Lewis, and another one is Cleveland Lee Lewis. And, that's the deep affection.
So how has doing all of this research impacted you personally?
Well, it's brought back a lot of stories. My two sisters here. One of them made the journey from Milwaukee to Orlando, Florida in 1960. Our father got a consulting project at Cape Canaveral. So we lived in Orlando. Well, we went from 120 inches of snow that went over our house down 2 days later, we were living in Orlando. So anyway, we're going through Tennessee. And my brother, who's 2 years older than me, turned to my mom after he had gone over to the colored water fountain and turned the water, and he yelled over to my mom, "The water's not colored." Those are the things that, you know, start coming back. I remembered, if you know anything about the segregation in the Orlando area and the Grove. It was, the Groveland was this horrible community, and our mother had just had a child. And a couple weeks later, we're doing this move, and it took a lot out of Mom. As they're writing about this, in the things I've read, I'm seeing Groveland, the shotgun shanties, the dirt, the, you know, the dogs with mange that I got to experience when I lived in Kentucky in the 1970s. It was still there. And so as I read this, I have these reference points, and I want to tell those stories. And this is part of what I'm doing here. I think there's a big story that needs to be told. So if you, I have some things I've laid over here that you can look at that I've been reading a lot more. I actually belong to a book club, and by chance we've been reading several books on this time period, and I'm finding references in there in the way this all works together. And it's like, you know, it's kind of like all these things are coming together and weaving to tell this story. And then to have the movie, The Green Book, come out recently, it was, you know, this just said that this story has to be told.
Everybody, please give Bruce a huge welcome. Time researching, I mean, this guy is a research consultant and data management person, and we've thrown some business cards out on the tables here. I was remiss of bringing this up earlier, and he works with Citizens for Integrity, but we're also, in case you noticed, taping today's program, so I think it's your intention that you want to make that available, and so sharing that card, sharing this information, broadening the story of Cleveland Abbott. That's part of the mission here today. Thank you guys for all being here. Bruce will hang around, I'm sure, and answer more questions if you have them. Thank you.
Thank you.